participants who need in some preliminaries. So I should start from the very beginning and give notations and definitions and try to move not very quickly. Okay, so I try to consider my screen. I know. Okay. So we can start. The first lecture will be devoted to some elements of fractional calculus and then to fractional Brownian motion, Wiener integration with respect to fractional Brownian motion and some related fractional processes. And it happens so that the lectures will be also finished with some elements of fractional calculus, especially with fractional differential equations. So this is the outline of our lectures and now some introduction. Fractional calculus is one of the best tools to characterize, on the one hand, long memory processes and materials, anomalous diffusion, long-range interactions, long-term behaviors, power laws, allometric scaling laws, and on the other hand, respective short memory effects, which hold especially in finance. So the corresponding mathematical models are on the one hand fractional processes and on the other hand fractional differential equations. Of course, this is a very simplified situation because the number of fractional objects is much greater. There can be partial fractional differential equations, partial fractional differential equations with stochastic noise, and so on. The evolutions of fractional processes behave in a much more complicated way. So to study the corresponding dynamics is much more difficult. But the study of such processes and equations is absolutely necessary because fractality is inherent in almost all observed phenomena. It manifests itself in particular in the fact that, for example, the transmission of cellular signals cannot be described by differential equations with derivatives of an integer order. They are not enough smooth for this to be described with such equations. It can be said that derivatives of the integer order that have been used to describe classical mechanical systems since Newton have become much luxury at the present time when we observe changes that occur too quickly in order to be residually smooth. So derivatives and integrals with integer indices are irreplaceable in describing insufficiently smooth phenomena in finance, economics, modern technologies, natural phenomena. And moreover, almost all of the above evolve according to very similar laws. And they are replaced with fractional order derivatives and fractional order integrals that describe some quasi-smoothness. Therefore, it is absolutely necessary to study and apply at least some elements of fractional calculus. What elements? One remark. During the whole lectures, I shall omit the technical details of the proofs. And I shall discuss only some principal details and some interesting details. So, many statements will be formulated without proof. Now start with the elements of fractional calculus. The first element is fractional integrals. It is a comparatively simple element because the definition of fractional integral is only one. And the definition of fractional derivative can be is multiple. So let alpha be bigger than zero, and in most cases alpha is less than one, and in most our cases it be less than one, but in general it is not obligatory. Then fractional Riemann Liouville left and right side integrals on some interval AB, any interval, integral of order alpha, is defined as an operator correspondingly, operator I plus and I minus. I omit all the subscripts and superscripts because it is a long story, of the following form. So here we have fractional integral from the left. You see that it is in general a convolution in of our function f with some power if alpha is more than zero and less than one strictly. We have here some negative power that exceeds minus one. So the integral exists, we understand, if at least f belongs to L1. And the corresponding thing is for the integral which starts from x and is to some right limit b. So the function under the sign of integral only change in this fraction, because here we have t minus x, x is left boundary, and here we have x minus t, x is right boundary. We say that the function f belongs to the domain of our operator, so symbol d denotes the domain of corresponding operator, if these integrals converge for almost all x with respect to Lebesgue measure. In general, we can, it is also in use, we can also define the Riemann-Liouville left and right sided fractional integrals from minus infinity and to infinity. From minus infinity, we have in general the same function as we when we consider from A, but you understand that the conditional function F will be a little bit different. And here we have the same function as we consider when here is B, but also the conditions of the function will be a little bit different. This normalizing multiplier gamma of alpha corresponds to the integral when we have here in general integral from 0 to 1 and from 1, but we shall omit, in general we shall write it, but omit in our consideration because it is not essential. We shall consider the function, but this normalizing factor will be present. Function f belongs to domain of one or another integral if the corresponding integrals converge, also for almost all x. The Biblia in fractional calculus is the book of Samko Kilbasmarichev, Fractional Integrals and Fractional Derivatives. According to this book, if we have a function from the space of ALPR and P is bigger or equal to 1, but does not exceed 1 over alpha, then we can integrate this function both from minus infinity to x and from x to minus, from x to plus infinity in such fractional manner. Moreover, we have a famous Hardy-Littlewood theorem. It states the following. What about if we have function from some space LP, what about the belonging of its fractional integral to some space LQ? So let we have P and Q something between one, but one of them can be one. You will see that both of them can be one, and alpha is from 0 to 1. We shall consider maybe some exercise concerning the boundary value on P and Q. Then the operators I plus minus alpha are bounded from LP to LQ if and only if P greater than one, so no one, Q equals p divided by this value, we can consider if it can be 1. It means in particular that what for any p in such interval strictly and q that equals to this value, or the difference of inverse numbers equals exactly alpha, there exists some constant such that the norm, this is the norm of fractional integral in LQR. And it is dominated by the norm of f in LP and some constant. This theorem is very applicable. However, the proof is rather long and technical, and I shall not present it. So only we shall remember that we can estimate and bound the norm in LQ of fractional integral by the norm of function that is integrated in some LP. Okay. What are the properties of fractional integration? First, fractional integration admits composition. So if we have consequently two fractional integrals, we have fractional integrals of this sum. It is valid for intervals, finite interval, you see here. And if the order of integration is sufficiently big, we have these equalities at any point x, otherwise only for almost all x. Here we have composition formula on the whole axis. However, there are some relations between p, alpha, and beta. You understand that when we integrate with some power, the power should not be considerably big, and alpha plus beta should be less than 1 over p. Another interesting property is the changing of sign of integration. Namely, if we have f from LP, everything is on the interval, and g from LQ, and we have that p and q are sufficiently big, so that inverse numbers in the total sum do not exceed 1 plus alpha. Some additional condition if we have here equality. We have the following integration by parts formula in some sense. So here we have integral of f, here we have integral of g, so we switch the integration, we switch fractional integration from f to g. But you understand that here we have integral from a, and here we have integral to b. The same thing is for the integrals over whole axis. If f from LP and g from LQ, they have the following relation with alpha, then also we can integrate by parts, switch our fractional integration here from alpha, and here we have g, and the order of integrals is switched from plus to minus. Next, let us consider some Hölder continuity. Hölder continuity will be useful throughout all our consideration. Let we have some set T. It can be interval, it can be the whole axis, and we define the set of Hölder continuous function from T to R. This is a notation of, and Hölder continuity of order lambda. What is it? This is function that acts from T to R with the following norm that is finite. Supremum norm plus Hölder norm itself. This is standard Hölder norm. Of course, we can use this notation for T that equals AB mostly, and it is applicable mostly for such situation. Even if people say something concerning Hölder functions on the whole axis, they have in mind the Hölder continuity on any interval. Now, let we consider some P that exceeds one or equal. And the node, we shall use this notation, the node the IA plus or minus from LP of R, the class of function F that can be presented as a Riemann-Liouville integral. And this function that is integrated belongs to LP. So if we have some function that belongs to LP for P, of course, starting from one, and we have a fractional integral from this function that exists, we assume this, then we say that function F belongs to this class. So if we have, the next result is, if we have some function from this class, and additionally, of course, alpha is simply positive and P is sufficiently big, alpha P exceeds one, then the function from this class is immediately Hölder continuous on any interval. You see that here we have Hölder continuity on finite interval, on any interval, however, on finite interval. And also not for all alpha, but only for alpha from zero, and it does not exceed alpha minus one over P. We have here that alpha is more than one over P. So we have Hölder continuity, however, only to such order. It is more or less clear. At first, it means that fractional integral increases the smoothness of function. We have the function that is fractional integral from some LP. Function from LP can be not so smooth, but the result of fractional integration is smooth, not to big order, however, at least to some order that is bounded by the value of alpha minus one over P. Why I emphasize that we consider Hölder property on any interval, but finite interval, because the norm in general, the norm can increase with the increasing of interval. So we cannot state the, in most cases, we cannot state the Hölder continuity simultaneously on the whole axis. However, on the fixed interval, we can fix it, but with some constant that depends on the length on the interval and on the endpoints. Okay. The next result is almost evident, but is useful for us. Let we have some alpha from zero to one. Let we have some function from LP, not for very high order, P is less than one alpha. And let we have this, that this integral equals zero. Then function F is zero. We can claim this. In this case, we have some kind of uniqueness. If we have the function if phi that is fractional integral of some given function f, then the function f is unique. Okay, and then we can define the inverse operator. Inverse operator is a fractional derivative, in some sense inverse operator. We will claim in which sense. So let us consider now the first definition of fractional derivative. In general, definition of fractional derivative of Riemann-Liouville type is unique, but its representation can be different. So the definition of fractional derivative of function f of order alpha is the following. We can notate it as integral minus alpha. We can give the notation that it is fractional derivative d of order alpha. But in any case, we have another normalizing factor. We have derivative, let us remember this. We have derivative of the corresponding fractional integral. Here we consider fractional integral from minus infinity n to plus infinity, but the form of fractional derivative in its definition will be the same. It is exactly the derivative of fractional integral. Fractional integral, if we define fractional derivative of order alpha, fractional integral is here, has here power minus alpha. It is not fractional integral of order alpha, of course. In the case of alpha, we have alpha minus one, but here we have minus alpha. It is another power. Minus alpha corresponds to the index alpha here, and we have fractional derivative. Okay, this is a form of fractional derivative. The same form, of course, is for interval, but let us consider a little bit this fractional derivative of LP of R. So for some P, starting from one but not one, the class of fractional integrals of order alpha from LP coincides with those function from LR. R is defined in such a way, for which the following integrals converge in LPR. So please pay attention that here, instead of fractional, instead of derivative as here we have derivative. However, what is the problem? The problem is that to take this derivative as it is very complicated in many cases. And now our efforts are what to do in order to avoid this differentiation as it is. Let us in some sense put this differentiation under the sign of integral. But you understand that immediately it is impossible, because here we have negative power. So we cannot put the derivative under the sign of integral directly. So we go in some indirect way. The first fact in this indirect way is the following, that instead of taking the derivative, we can consider integrals of the following form. We can guess how it has happened. Indeed, if function f is really differentiable, we can write this difference as the integral of its derivative and replace the limits of integration. We shall do it, but a little bit later. Now we shall fix this fact. But having in mind this fact, we can state that for functions of the following class that are fractional integrals from LP, the Riemann-Liouville derivative coincides with corresponding so-called Marchaud derivative. Marchaud derivative also exists, have the right to exist. We shall not apply them very often. However, they demonstrate how to avoid the operation of taking derivative. Now, what about interval? On any interval, of course, we can consider a Riemann-Liouville fractional derivatives. We introduce the corresponding class, the functions of fractional integrals from LP. So our function from this class is represented in the following way. Okay, so we can consider correspondingly as here we have right side integral, it does not matter, principally only technically. And in this case, we can denote our fractional derivative in the following way. We know that this integral is defined. It is the subject of some exercise. And maybe we can differentiate. It is not clear for the moment, maybe. And if we can differentiate, we define fractional derivative as well, and as in the previous case, also in this case, we define this fractional derivative as a derivative, not knowing from the very beginning that we can differentiate. It is in some sense formal definition. Some informal things are here. And again, we return to some formal definition for fractional derivative on the interval. It will be used more often, so let us fix this notation. Again, we have derivative of fractional integral, however, we don't know if this derivative exists. This is only a formal definition. But if we can differentiate, then fractional derivative, it means the following value presentation. We assume that function f is zero outside our interval, then we can reduce fractional derivative to the following form. This form, of course, is much more applicable. Again, we exclude the operation of taking derivative here. So in some sense, we can consider this as some alternative definition of fractional derivative. However, let us consider when we can take this derivative. Also, one theorem from Sankoh-Kilbas and Marichev helps us. We can state that function f is fractional integral, and in turn, it means that we can take fractional derivative of this function if and only if we have the following. So let us compare. Here we have two terms. And so we state that our function can be, can admit fractional derivative if and only if the first term belongs to LP. And for the second term, we have the following property. Here is a part of second term, but only integral from R to X minus epsilon. We consider corresponding integral. We integrate on the whole interval and assume that taking the supremum in epsilon does not give us infinity. The supremum is, assume that it is finite. In this case, we can take fractional derivative. Now, what about fractional derivative and fractional integral as the inverse operator? The first property, let me start with this one. Of course, this one is much more easy to prove, because we can take the function for which fractional derivative on the interval is defined. It is enough to take function f from L1. We have correctly defined fractional integral. And then taking the fractional derivative, it will be one of the exercises. Only leads to the convolution of corresponding powers alpha minus one and minus alpha. This convolution equals some constant. And we immediately have the function f free of any integration and differentiation, because we have derivative of integral of f and nothing else, it is f. Of course, almost everywhere. This property is, in its proof, more complicated, because we can take only functions from this class. But if we have the function from this class, we apply the fractional derivative to this function, which is in turn fractional integral, and nothing else. We immediately get fractional integral of function phi for which f is fractional integral. So this is function f. Those participants who will be on exercises will see how it is stated. Okay. So for function for which we have correctly defined fractional derivative, we can apply fractional integral of the same order and get function f. And simply for function f over L1, we can at first integrate, then differentiate, and get the function f again. Composition formula for fractional derivatives has a corresponding form. We have fractional derivative beta alpha and have fractional derivative of alpha plus beta. However, the situation is the following. If the function f belongs to this class, then it belongs to this class for differentiation. And then the result can be differentiated and we get this composition formula. But only if the right-hand side is correctly defined. We understand that taking the fractional derivative leads to some less smooth function. Taking the fractional integral leads to some increasing of smooth, and taking the fractional derivative leads to some less smooth functions. Okay, now about integration by parts with fractional derivatives. We have some standard alpha, some alpha can be named as standard. We have function which is fractional integral of order alpha from LP, fractional integral of order alpha from LQ, P and Q are sufficiently large, and then we have integration by parts. We can switch fractional derivatives from F to J and from A to B. Some words concerning Caputo derivatives. We shall apply them to fractional differential equations at the end of the lectures. However, some words on them now. Let we have function, let we have alpha from 0 to 1, standard alpha, and let we have function which is definitely differentiable, continuously differentiable. Then we, of course, can take fractional derivatives because function admits even derivative of the order 1. It means that it admits derivatives or all order alpha less than one. So the derivative exists. They belong to LR for not so big R less than one over alpha. And what is interesting, we can consider a little bit another form. It is simply the result of calculation. So for function from class C1, Riemann-Liouville fractional derivative can be represented in such a way. In this case, we can insert the differentiation under the sign of integral. We get here derivative, exactly derivative, but we have one additional term. This is for Riemann-Liouville derivative. If we consider only the integral here, we get so-called Caputo derivatives. Caputo derivatives are widely applicable in fractional calculus, and so they have the following form. Simply derivative under the sign of integral, so some fractional integral but of the derivative with the same multiplier normalizing factor as before. And so Caputo derivative is Riemann-Liouville derivative minus this additional term. In some sense, it is more convenient when we apply these derivatives to some Markov processes, when we want to consider the generators. In some cases, it is not convenient to have this additional term, and we go to Caputo derivatives, and the difference between derivatives leads to the difference between the corresponding generators. Everything is connected when we apply these notions to some even not fractional processes, to some Markov processes, but this is another story. So both the derivatives are useful. In fractional stochastic calculus, Riemann-Liouville derivatives are more useful in application to some fractional, even stochastic processes, but not fractional Brownian motion and not especially to Markov processes, Caputo derivatives are more applicable. Okay. Now, let us consider one particular case. Let we have a function that is in some sense a generalized indicator function. If we have a standard interval AB, it is simply one. If the limits interchange, we have minus one indicator of t that belongs to AB, but the limits are interchanging, and zero otherwise. From some point of view, we shall consider it some slides later. We will be interested in the fractional integral of this indicator. So let we have some index h. Some index h appears. I can say immediately that it will be Hurst index for fractional Brownian motion. In this connection, we are interested in interval 0, 1, but for the moment, we are not interested in 1 half. So let it be only interval from 0 to 1 half open and 1 half to 1. And let alpha, it will be notation throughout the lectures, is h minus 1 half. So for the moment, alpha often equals h minus 1 half. I shall explain if it will be necessary. Then for all t from r, fractional integral, this is a fractional integral from minus infinity of our generalized indicator equals to the following kernel. In some sense, it is a Volterra kernel. This is exactly part of Volterra kernel. However, here we get some additional term which does not depend on t. The proof is technical. We simply calculate the fractional integral. So I shall omit these techniques. You see that we have the calculations, and if you will be interested, you can look them at slides. Okay, and now having this formula, we can start with fractional Brownian motion. So now we come to some stochastic objects. Let omega fp be a complete probability space. And at first we define two-sided and also normalized fractional Brownian motion. What does it mean normalized? We want for its second moment, for example, its second moment at one to be one. And normalization is introduced in this connection. So two-sided normalized fractional Brownian motion with Hurst index h from 0 to 1. Here we have all the indices from 0 to 1, not 1, not 0. Is a stochastic Gaussian process on this complete probability space having the following properties? It starts from 0. Mathematical expectation is zero, and covariance function is of the following form. Here, absolute values are because we take in mind that ST can be negative. Of course, everybody knows that stochastic Gaussian process is defined only by its mean and covariance, and this property is not so necessary to formulate. However, this is a tradition to say, let we have process starting from zero with zero mean and the following covariance function. I can say immediately that this function will be covariance only, indeed, only for h from zero to one. It will be not covariance for h greater than one. So it is natural to consider these indices. Yes, let us consider, let us go ahead. The first fact that we can formulate concerning the fractional Brownian motion is the second moment of its increment. It equals, from this formula, it follows immediately that it equals gives t minus s, of course, absolute value to power 2h. This process is Gaussian. What can we immediately produce from this, simply from this equality? First that we can do, if it is Gaussian, then we can write all the moments. It is an interesting story for us because we can immediately state not simply continuity of some modification, but Hölder property. How to do it? We know that from Kolmogorov theorem that the sufficient condition of Hölder continuity of some order rho of the trajectories of some process X is the following one. If we have such an equality for some n, and here for such index, but exactly it should be greater than one. This part should be positive. N positive, rho positive. In this case, we can state that process is Hölder up to order rho. So we take this power, subtract one, and divide by this, and we get rho. In our case, we can put, you see here, we subtract one, we get nh minus one, and divide by n, and we get rho equals h minus one over n, and n can be arbitrary. So we get Hölder property of the trajectories of fractional Brownian motion up to order h, not h, of course, it is not so, but up to order h. The same as the Wiener process is Hölder up to order 1/2, but not 1/2. If we have h equals one, this extra case. In this case, this case is not included into initial definition. However, we can set that it will be natural to take the limit of covariance function and set that in this case, fractional Brownian motion is simply linear function. Here we have some standard normal random variable, and here we have t. Of course, in this case, we understand what will be the covariance function. What about zero? The problem with zero is more complicated. If h equals zero, we can consider fractional Brownian motion with index zero as a weak limit of fractional Brownian motions when h tends to zero. This weak limit exists, however, in the limit we get noisy function. We have some process with independent values and Gaussian, noisy function. So we understand that the smoothness of fractional Brownian motion increases with h. For h equals zero, we have noise, then the smoothness increases to Wiener process, because for h equals 1/2, we have Wiener process, and then it increases to linear function, which is very smooth, simply Lipschitz function. Okay, this, it concerns two-sided fractional Brownian motion. In some problems, two-sided fractional Brownian motion is needed. In some problems, we should restrict ourselves to fractional Brownian motion that starts from zero. Why? Because if we have some applications of fractional Brownian motion, for us it's much more convenient to start from one. For example, if we come to some finance organization, some market, and for us zero is the moment when we arrive. For us the whole prehistory is not very important. We start from our zero. So, but in some cases minus infinity is important. I shall emphasize in which cases. So it is possible to consider fractional Brownian motion only on R plus. with evident changes in our definition, what will be the changes? Only here we can omit here absolute value, only in these two places, and everything else is the same. Okay. What about characteristic function? It has the following form because we have our covariance function and we have zero mean. So the characteristic function contains only covariance matrix. The story with covariance matrix is very interesting. It is non-degenerate, but to deal with the inverse matrix is a very complicated problem. We shall consider this in financial application. It is an interesting story with this matrix. We understand that if we take here instead of so t here is some vector and here are some coordinates of this vector, and if we take instead of t some alpha t and corresponding alpha here, we see that according to homogeneity of covariance function, you see that in all terms we have power 2h. This power will be can be put from the sign of this inner product, and we get immediately alpha to power 2h, which corresponds to here. Alpha to power 2h immediately appears, and it appears here. What does it mean? It means that we have self-similar stochastic process. In general, stochastic process is called beta self-similar if we have any finite dimensional distribution and we have scaling in time, then we immediately get scaling in space. Scaling, but with some index beta, which is the index of self-similarity. It follows from the initial definition and this formula that BH is H self-similar. So it is self-similar process. Also, we can state from this property that it has stationary increments, but let us return to stationarity of increments. It is better, people consider the previous property, however, it is more precisely to consider this formula. And you see here only the differences of the time moments. And immediately we get that the process has stationary increments. Of course, it is not stationary itself. So in this sense, fractional Brownian motion is similar to Wiener process. Wiener process is self-similar with index beta 1/2. Of course, it has stationary increments, but it has more, it has independent increments. And also it is not stationary itself. The same is true for fractional Brownian motion. However, the increments are not independent. They are simply stationary. And only in the case h equals 1/2, increments are non-correlated. You can see it immediately when we have here 1, 1, 1, 1, we can subtract and we get zero. And in this case, fractional Brownian motion is Wiener process. Again, alpha, I recall because I am afraid that we forget. And now let us deal a little bit with increments of fractional Brownian motion. Let us consider some subsequent points. Subsequent h, we exclude the case 1/2. It is not interesting because we know that in the case 1/2 we have a Wiener process, and then we have four subsequent moments of time. Then we can take the previous formula. We know the sign of every term, and we can combine them because this is the increment of integral, which integral? The integral of the following form. So we have double increment because this increment is on the plane of which function? Of this kernel. This kernel is very important. It appears in many problems, and the power of this kernel is 2h minus 2 because we differentiate two times. Initially we had 2h and we take difference and then difference of differences, and we differentiate two times. After this two times differentiating, we get the power 2h minus 2, but alpha in our notation equals h minus 1 half. So in other sense, this is the same, 2 alpha minus 1. 2 alpha minus 1 equals 2h minus 2. And here we have the power which appears when we differentiate. First time we differentiate, we get 2h. Second time we get 2h minus 1, but here we have 1 half, so 2h becomes simply h. It is not interesting factor, but this factor is very interesting because if h is more than 1, if h is, excuse me, if h is more than 1 half, this is positive. If h is less than 1 half, it is negative. It means that the increments of fractional Brownian motion are positively correlated for bigger h, bigger than 1 half, and negatively correlated for h from 0 to 1 half. So the sign of correlations change when we switch from interval 0, 1 half to interval 1 half, 1. Moreover, let us consider particular situation. Let here we have T4 equals n plus 1, T3 equals n, T2 equals 1, and T1 equals 0. Then we get the very well-known formula. We get that the following coefficient equals this integral, and when we analyze its asymptotical behavior, let us consider simply n to plus infinity. Of course, we can consider any n, but let us consider to plus infinity. In this case, we have integral over some positive rectangle. And it is, when n tends to infinity, it is equivalent to the following value, n to power to alpha minus 1 or to h minus 2. It means that if h is from 0 to 1 half, then the corresponding series converges. And if h is from 1 half to 1, then the corresponding series diverges. In this case, people say that for h from 1 half to 1, fractional Brownian motion has a property of long range dependence, and vice versa. For h from 0 to 1 half, it has a property of short range dependence. When people ask, please, when we use these terms, what does it mean? What it means? Simply the convergence or divergence, the corresponding series of covariance. But it is not simply, it is not formal. It is informal approach because we understand that in this case, we have very fast tending to zero of covariance, short memory. Our increments does not remember well, but in this case we have covariance which is infinite in the limit. We have long memories, increments remember well the past. So this not formal definitions, but are natural. Okay, now.
Maybe it's a nice time to stop. It's 10:52.
Yelena, yes, up to you. I shall hear you. Yes, please stop.
So it's probably a natural stop right now, yes?
Yes, it's possible, yes. I agree.
Okay. So I can see that there are no questions in chat right now. So any questions? So to ask a question, please unmute yourself and use your voice.
Yes, I have a question. So on the part on fractional integrals and fractional derivatives, because there was this lemma about embedding in older spaces. And so I was a bit wondering, because like the embedding basically in terms of regularity of the coefficients, it's sort of an analog of like Sobolev or fractional Sobolev classical types of embeddings. So I was trying to understand if there is a relation between the two.
So let me come. Okay. Here, so let me return to fractional derivatives. You have in mind what fractional integrals, yes, you have in mind definition?
Yes.
Okay, this is the initial definition, and this is here also initial definition. And what is the question?
It was about, there was a lemma about embedding in older spaces.
Embedding on which spaces of functions that admit derivative?
I mean, there was some lemma, three, one point something.
Maybe this one.
There was really a lemma. I mean, it was in a block with the title lemma and the number.
May I have a suggestion for next time?
Yes.
Please remember the page. Yeah. If you ask a question, please try to, you know, write the page number. Then it will be much easier to find.
No, sorry, it's not this one. It's it has a similar statement, but it's saying like, yeah.
This one. Yes. This lemma is simply to demonstrate that we have increasing of smoothness. But I don't see that, I don't say that it is difficult or simple. So we have function from LP. We integrate and get the Hölder function on this Hölder index.
Yeah. Is that, I mean, if I look at the parameters, it feels like a Sobolev embedding because yeah. We're in dimension one. And it's
Yes, of course. Sobolev embedding also is based on such fact.
What I was asking is the connection.
Yes, in some sense, they are equivalent, of course.
They are equivalent. I mean, like E alpha LP is a Sobolev space, or?
Is embedded.
Okay, and in which
embedded space? Embedded is this one. I shall consider the Sobolev and Bessov integration. We shall return to this question. We
can. Okay, perfect. Thank you.
If I succeed today, if not tomorrow.
Okay. So, any more questions? So if not, it's a short break of about 3 minutes and we return in 3 minutes, okay? Well, okay, I think we should continue now. So thank you, Yuliya. Please proceed.
Thank you, Lena, and thank you to everybody who is with us now. And so let us consider two-sided Wiener process. So we are going to introduce fractional Brownian motion with some integral representation, because simply to have covariance function is very interesting and very useful in some cases. However, some integral representation will help to include the fractional Brownian motion into the problems of stochastic calculus. The first integral representation of fractional Brownian motion belongs to Mandelbrot-Van-Ness. I don't think that Benoit Mandelbrot knew the elements of fractional calculus. My guess is that he proposed some fractional Volterra kernel, and in order to have the finite integral, this additional term was proposed. This is my guess, I don't know exactly. But we were lucky that their kernel is a fractional integral of indicator of interval, which we have calculated previously. So let me have two-sided Wiener process. It is a Gaussian process with independent increments with zero mean and covariance function of the following form. Let me have this fractional kernel that is a fractional integral of indicator function of the interval. Then it was stated by Mandelbrot and Van Ness that the following process, which is the integral for Wiener with respect to Wiener process of this fractional kernel, is a fractional Brownian motion. And this constant is a normalizing factor in order to get variance one at point one. And it was calculated several times by different authors with different forms. This is one of possible forms of this integral. And the statement is that we have a normalized two-sided fractional Brownian motion when integrate with respect to Wiener process. In general, if we integrate with respect to Wiener process some non-random function over some interval, in our case, this is a whole axis, at first, we need to check that this integral is correctly defined. How to check it? We should check that integral over the whole axis of the square of this kernel with respect to the back measure is finite. This is sufficient for us. And I shall not go into all details. However, at first, we indeed check that this second moment exists. After some calculations, we get two different integrals. This is a standard story for fractional Brownian motion. One integral from minus infinity to the index that is less. Another is between the points. These integrals are independent. And then we can calculate these integrals. Both of them are finite. And when we substitute this second moment in the formula for covariance, we get two moments that we already calculated, and similarly, we can calculate the second moment of increment of our integral representation, and we get covariance function. That's all. So we indeed have fractional Brownian motion. How to integrate the functions with respect to fractional Brownian motion? We return to our representation and we see that fractional Brownian motion itself is the integral with respect to Wiener process of fractional integral, but of some interval, in our case, zero t. The next guess is to define fractional integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion as the fractional integral, but not of indicator of integral, but of integrand. And this is a correct guess. So let us define integral operator. It is often noted as m to index h, but this is simply fractional integral of power alpha. Alpha is h minus 1/2. And this is simply normalizing factor. Here it is. Of course, if we have 1/2, we don't need in any fractional integration and we put our operator is the function under the sign of operator. Now, some long story starts, but I don't go into the whole details of this story and only give some lines. So let us consider the space L to H. This is a space of function for which when we apply this fractional integration to our function, we are in L2 of R. Of course, we shall equip it with the norm, and the norm in this space is simply the norm of fractional integral in L2. And then we immediately can define integral of with respect to fractional Brownian motion. Let our function belongs to this space. So for this function, we can take its fractional integral, and fractional integral belongs to L2. And now we simply integrate this fractional integral of f with respect to Wiener process, and we understand this, that this integral is correctly defined because this integrand belongs to L2, and we can integrate this square with respect to Lebesgue measure. We shall get some finite value. So this integral is correctly defined, but it is correctly defined, and it is defined according to our intuition that we decided. Let we have fractional Brownian motion. It is integral of fractional integral of indicator. Let us replace indicator with some function f, and let's say it will be the integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion. Here we, in some sense, we switch the operator of fraction, in some sense, fractional operator, but it moves from the function bh to which we integrate to the function which is integrated. But is it really some good definition, some natural definition? Okay. Let us consider a particular case. Consider stepwise function that has a form simply the linear combination of intervals. We know what will be when we act by our fractional integral on any indicator. And immediately we get from the linearity of the operator of fractional integration, integral that we call the integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion equals the following value. Here is a linear combination with AK. We act by our operator to interval, but when we act by our operator to integral, we immediately get the increment of fractional Brownian motion. Because when we act on interval 0t, we get fractional Brownian motion. So here we have the increment. And this definition, this formula coincides with usual Riemann-Hiltzius sum. So the question arises, in what sense can we consider formula, previous one, this one, as the extension of the sum, this one, this sum. Note for the stepwise function, we have the following formula, and for f that belongs to class L to H, this integral is correctly defined. Everything is good. Situation is different for H from 0, 1 half, and for H from 1 half to 1. However, there is one fact that holds for any H. This fact, in some sense, justifies our definition. For any h from 0 to 1, the linear span of the set of our, here you have, of our in general, this is simply fractional integrals of indicators, is dense in one in L2. So indeed, we can consider the closure of our sums and get the integral. So this lemma justifies why the closure of these sums will be the integral that we define. There are different points of view on such integration. However, this fact is true. if we consider this integral for functions f from L to h, we get in some sense natural definition of integral, and it is used. Integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion. However, this definition is much more easy to consider when we have, so this definition is for all h. However, it is much more convenient to consider this definition for h more than 1/2. And this is the reason why the theory of fractional Brownian motion with Hurst index h more than 1/2 was considered for many years, and only now people switch to h less than 1/2. One of the facts that is the reason of it is this formula. Because if we integrate for the whole R2, you see that on diagonal for h less than 1/2, we have here we have 2h minus 2. If h is less than 1/2, 2h is less than 1, and then we have a bad singularity. Integral does not exist. So our formula is good for any h, but this equality holds only for h from 1/2 to 1. And to consider the integral is much more convenient for big h. This is the reason why a lot of stochastic calculus for fractional Brownian motion is considered originally only for big h. Okay. Now, we are equated with some facts for two-sided fractional Brownian motion. And we see that, of course, it is good to have such a fractional kernel, which is fractional integral of indicator. However, for the first, it is not very convenient to integrate from minus infinity. Please imagine what will be when we want to simulate the trajectories of fractional Brownian motion. If we want to simulate, for example, 1 billion trajectories, and every time to integrate from minus infinity, we will get a lot of mistake. This is one reason, and another reason is analytical. It is not so convenient to consider integral from minus infinity from analytical point of view. From the times of Mandelbrot-Van-Ness to the times of early 19th, the history of fractional Brownian motion is not very extended. And this history accelerated in early 19th, and the story, maybe I simplify some facts, but the story starts with very well known for that times firm Nokia. It was the greatest firm for that time in Europe. They produce the first devices for mobile connection, and they understood that in this connection some memory appears, that devices remember the past. They try to consider which model is suitable for this situation. And their attention was paid to fractional Brownian motion. There were some analytical people who worked in connection with this firm. And it was a famous paper of Noras, Valkeila, Virtamo, in which they presented the compact interval representation of fractional Brownian motion. This compact interval representation leads to very high speed of development of fractional stochastic calculus. So let us consider this representation. Our goal is to consider one-sided fractional Brownian motion and to represent it as a function of some Wiener process. It will be another Wiener process that participates in Mandelbrot-Van-Ness representation. However, the goal is the same, to find find such Walter kernel, which when integrated with respect to Wiener process, gives us a Gaussian process with the same covariance function as fractional Brownian motion. And now on this way, we introduce the following kernels. Of course, we go by the known results. So we know what which kernels we need to introduce. One kernel is of the following form. I recall that alpha is h minus 1/2, and this is normalizing factors. In many problems, normalizing factors are not very important. However, we consider the problem and even have written the whole book in which this coefficient play a leading role. However, for us, they will not be very, very important. So this is the kernel which translates fractional Brownian motion into Wiener process. This kernel translates Wiener process into fractional Brownian motion. You see that the form of the kernel is not very convenient. It contains several powers and even some difference, not very convenient to deal with. However, for h more than 1/2, it can be simplified. So here are the normalizing factors. Okay. Now one technical result that is interesting. Why? Because here we have this kernel. We want to integrate this kernel with respect to fractional Brownian motion. And we know that for h more than 1/2, the second moment will have this value. So for us, it is interesting if it is finite. Yes, it is. Okay. So we can, if we have this situation, covariance of integral exists, we can consider the integral itself. Integral of this kernel with respect to fractional Brownian motion is considered as it can be done for any h from 0 to 1 as a fractional integral with respect to our kernel and with respect to some underlying Wiener process. This Wiener process comes from Mandelbrot-Vanessa presentation and from our definition. I recall it. Here is our definition. In this formula, fractional Brownian motion and Wiener process are connected as in Mandelbrot-Vanessa representation. So one time more, we return to Mandelbrot-Vanessa representation, at least to state that this integral exists. And now we cancel this last formula and consider this integral as it is. Some technical transformations, after them, we can calculate the covariance of these integrals in different time moments. We can calculate it easily when h is more than 1/2, we know that the integral exists. Some calculations and we get the result. Okay. Now, what we have here? We have some Gaussian process. We have its covariance function. If we have covariance and we understand that is mean equals zero, of course, it is centered, then we immediately consider the increments. And we see that the increments are non-correlated. Here we have interval st. Here we have non-overlapping interval s prime t prime. And we get from the previous formula immediately that the increments are non-correlated. If they are non-correlated and the process is Gaussian, then they are independent. So we have our process. This is Gaussian process with independent increments and any process which is centered with independent increments can be characterized as a martingale with respect, of course, to its natural filtration. filtration generated by the process itself. So we have Gaussian martingale having independent increments and with the following characteristic function. We can, on the one hand, we can immediately apply Lewis theorem, which states that if we have characteristic function that is integrable, absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure here, then there exists some Wiener process for which we have Lewis representation. You see, when we consider the second moment, we take s to power minus 2 alpha, integrate with respect to ds, and get this function. Okay. On the other hand, the process itself is called Molchan-Martingale historically because it was considered for the first time in the papers of Molchan and Golosu. However, nobody will take these papers because they are very theoretical and not convenient for application. And the achievements of Norris, Valkale, and Virtamo was that they translated analytical formula of Molchan to some very simple calculations. What about h from 0 to 1/2? Oh, it's not so easy. We cannot consider this integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion as before, because in this case, such formula is not valid. This kernel does not permit to get the formula of the similar form. People in this case go indirectly. They try to integrate by parts, but to integrate by parts, we should have some good properties of integrand. If integrand is of bounded variation, then we can indeed integrate by parts. We have the product of the function nt at zero fractional Brownian motion at zero minus integral of fractional Brownian motion. We know that it has a Hölder modification. We consider its Hölder modification. And of course, we can integrate this modification with respect to function of bounded variation because modification is continuous, everything is okay. So this integral via this formula is correctly defined. Now, we see that our kernel is continuous, is of bounded variation. For small h, it is more smooth. And we can apply integration by parts and calculate the covariance function of the result of such integration. There are technical details which I promised to omit, and I omit all these calculations. And after some technical calculations, we get the same result. We get the same result after integration by parts that our integral again has uncorrelated increments. The same as in the case h is more than 1/2. It is Gaussian, and therefore it admits the following representation. So we prove the following result. For any h, let bh be an, a fractional Brownian motion, then Molchan-Martingale, which is a result of integration of our kernel with respect to fractional Brownian motion, is indeed a martingale. It is, in some sense, it is a great achievement because we started from fractional Brownian motion, which is not semi-martingale even, which is not Markov process, which is not martingale, which does not have independent increments. And we integrated a special kernel and get a very convenient process from which it is one step to Wiener process. And now we can go in this direction and represent Wiener process via fractional Brownian motion and vice versa. There are a lot of formulas any processes on this way can be connected via some analytic formula. But it is not our goal now to present all the formulas. You see, we have a lot of them, and we can represent fractional Brownian motion via the process y in turn is the integral of such kernel, so on. Everything is possible. However, for us, it is interesting only the result. And the result is the following one. First, we can represent fractional Brownian motion as a result of integration of our inconvenient kernel, but with some Wiener process. Wiener process appears in the representation of Molchan-Martingale. It is another Wiener process that participates in Mandelbrot-Vanesse representation. However, we know that there is a lot of Wiener processes. And let us use those processes that appears in this representation. I shall recall what is MH. MH is MH is here, you see, not very convenient kernel. However, we have no another one. This kernel forever. And this kernel participates in the representation of Molchan-Martingale when we integrate it with respect to fractional Brownian motion. And so for the moment, we can forget on it. And we can remember for the future only this result. When is our result? Our result is here. Our result is formula 26. This is a representation of fractional Brownian motion as an integral with respect to Wiener process, and our comparatively inconvenient, but only one Volterra kernel. If we have H is more than 1/2, another reason to consider this H is that in this case, we can simplify our kernel. I can explain in two words why it can be. So this is our kernel. And if H is more than 1/2, we can integrate by parts and get here alpha, here alpha minus one, but if H is more than 1/2, we get alpha minus one equals to H minus three divided by two, H is more than 1/2, so the power is more than minus one, and is integrable. If H is less than 1/2, we cannot do it. So I return to our simplified value, which helps us. Here is a simplification. Of course, it is not very convenient. However, two times simpler than the previous one, only one integral. We have our representation. We have the representation fractional Brownian motion on the compact interval. And now we stop with the representation, and I shall introduce only to demonstrate that in general, there can be not only fractional Brownian motion, but another fractional processes with another kernels, with another covariance functions. So not to restrict ourselves to fractional Brownian motion, however, to look to some generalization. I shall consider only three of them. For example, subfractional Brownian motion. Let us consider again zero mean Gaussian process with the covariance function of the following form. You see that it is a little bit different from the previous one. In previous case, we have only T minus S here and here. Let it be T plus S. It is also a covariance function. Why? It is not evident from the very beginning that it is covariance function, but we immediately can justify that it is a covariance on the next slide. This process was introduced by Badetsky-Gorostiza in connection with the occupation time fluctuations of branching particle systems. So this process appears as some limit of very well-known processes. In the case H equals 1/2, it coincides with the standard Brownian motion. When H is not 1/2, it is in a sense a process intermediate between a standard Brownian motion and fractional Brownian motion. Therefore, it is named subfractional. It has non-stationary increments in contrast to fractional Brownian motion, who has stationary increments, but its incremental covariance satisfies the following inequalities. And these inequalities are very important. What is the sort of these inequalities? On the left, we have t minus s to power 2h. And for fractional Brownian motion, we have here equality. From the right, we have the same function, but with some coefficient. It is a very well-developed theory of such Gaussian processes. They were introduced with the name of quasi-helix. So in this sense, all processes that we consider Wiener process, fractional Brownian motion, subfractional Brownian motion are quasi-helixes. These two-sided bounds allow to give some stochastic properties of the integrals with respect to corresponding Gaussian process. And some other maximal inequalities and so on. Now another process by fractional Brownian motion. Let we have now two indices, H and K. You understand that in general, when the model is more complicated, it is not of big use. However, in some models, we need this in bifractional Brownian motion. So its covariance function is of the following form. When K equals one, we have fractional Brownian motion again. And the process BHK satisfies the inequalities of the same form. We have 2H, but instead of simply 2H, 2HK here. In some sense, they are not self-similar, but between two self-similarities. They are situated between two self-similarities. In this case, bifractional Brownian motion is also a quasi-helix. Now, mixed fractional Brownian motion, it is another story. It is simply the linear combination, but let it be simply a sum of Wiener process and fractional Brownian motion. And we assume that the components are independent. This process is flexible for modeling because for mixed fractional Brownian motion, we can take into consideration on some smaller scale, it behaves like a Wiener process. On the larger scale, it behaves like fractional Brownian motion. So it is more flexible. This process was introduced by Patrick Cheredita in his PhD thesis and some papers, and now it is very popular. And that's all with this theory, and I shall comment some references. So the paper of Bender also, the paper and thesis justify some questions of integration. Badetsky, Gorostiza, and Talarchuk, this is the exact reference to origination of subfractional. This is a reference to paper of Patrick Cherigito, mixed fractional Brownian motion, some analytic papers, and what is more interesting for us? This is a paper of Lino Allard, which was one of the first to consider bifractional Brownian motion. Of course, Mandelbrot-Vaness, book of Lipser-Shiryaev forever for many calculations. This is a pioneer paper of fractional Brownian motion. The papers of Molchan, Norris, Valkela, Virtamo, differential equations will be later. This is a book that I name as Biblia of fractional integration and differentiation. And maybe that's all with this lecture. And I can go to the next one, if you don't object.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. It was wonderful. We have a few questions.
Okay.
Yeah, the first question is from Benjamin, and he asked quasi what I didn't understand. I guess it was about 5 minutes ago, quasi something. Or probably Benjamin would like to ask himself the question.
Yes, of course.
If you can unmute yourself, Benjamin, and ask a question.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, just the second word, I didn't quite catch it. Just to search for it online, quasi what? A process where the covariance is between two other covariances?
Yes, quasi helix, yes. This notion appeared from the situation when we tried, it was a common work with Alexander Novikov and Mikhail Zhitluhin. We started to consider the properties of the maximum of fractional Brownian motion on some interval. But the distribution and even the value of mean of maximum of fractional Brownian motion in any interval is unknown until now. Nobody knows the good formula for distribution of this maximum. However, we observed that the properties of maximum of Gaussian process is not specific for fractional Brownian motion. They are specific for the processes for which the covariance incremental function is between two self-similarities. When we have the same power, it is helix. When we have different powers, it can be so. It is quasi-helix. Quasi-helix is our know-how. We observed that even for quasi-helix, it is another story. I shall not include it into the lectures, but it is an interesting story. We observed that for quasi-helix, limit behavior of maximum when the index, for example, for fractional Brownian motion, h tends to zero, or for other processes when they lay between two self-similarities, if the index of self-similarity tends to zero, then this limit behavior is the same, and we can describe it. From that reason, this notion appeared. If it is the answer on your question.
Brilliant, thank you, yes.
Yes, excuse me, this is the second one.
Yeah, so the second question is from Lucio. Do these processes of fractional VM by fractional VM still admit the Volterra kernel type of representation?
Yes, of course. For subfractional Brownian motion, it is a very interesting story. I think that I put it on the next lecture. Because subfractional Brownian motion can be represented as a linear combination of fractional Brownian motion. One fractional Brownian motion is from zero to infinity, another one is from minus infinity to zero. And every of them admits some integral representation, therefore it is It is valid for subfractional Brownian motion too. Concerning bifractional Brownian motion, I don't know. I don't know exactly. I know. If you want, let go. I can give you as a reference. It is a good, very good paper of Kyprian Tudor. He presented bifractional Brownian motion, but the representation is so inconvenient and it contains some special functions. If the representation of fractional Brownian motion contains a Volterra kernel, and Volterra kernel is in exact form for bifractional Brownian motion, we have some special function. But if you wish, I can find this reference. This reference is contained in our book with Munir Zili, subfractional Brownian motion and related processes. So I can send it.
Any more questions? Well, it seems that no questions so far. We have about 15 minutes left.
Yes, so, I can start with some preliminaries with stochastic integration. Of course, it is not, we cannot restrict ourselves simply with integration of non-random functions with respect to fractional Brownian motion. We should integrate at least fractional Brownian motion with respect to fractional Brownian motion and observe what it will be. And integrate much more general functions. So let us consider the preliminaries of stochastic integration with respect to fractional Brownian motion. Here we have some considerations for fractional Sobolev type spaces and for fractional Besov type spaces. So what is the inconvenience? Of course, the inconvenience to integrate with fractional Brownian motion is that it has no bounded variation. It has no martingale property, but we know that the most convenient cases is to integrate in Lebesgue sense and to integrate in Itô sense. So neither of these approaches works. We need in some other approaches. In general, there are several approaches. Skoroход approach, weak approach, and passwise approach. As to me, the passwise approach is more convenient because it is applicable to finance, for example, to economy, and no body of financial practitioners, some quants will integrate in Skoroход sense, but in pathway sense, the integration is very convenient. It is in some convenient cases, integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion is simply the limit of integral sums, of Riemann integral sums, yes. But to go to this case, we shall go some way. And to start with this way, let us consider passwise integrals for processes F in the fractional Sobolev type spaces. It was a question concerning these spaces. Sobolev type space, indeed, they are Sobolev type. The spaces of fractional integrals of functions from LP. This approach was developed by Martin Azzelli in several works and several here papers, and it works till now. But this approach in some sense is omega by omega. Therefore, we can start simply with some non-random functions. And this approach, you will see, can be applied to integrators that is, for example, Hölder. We will see up to what order. So let us start. Consider two non-random functions, f and g. They are defined on some interval. Suppose that the limits for A from the right exist and for G from the left. If we don't want to overload ourselves with these details, let us suppose that they are simply continuous. Now we need to connect this function in connection this function to the endpoints of the interval. So function f is connected to the left endpoint, and function g is connected to the right point. And we can simply assume that this is simply the value g of b, f of a, let it be. Now we assume that this connected function belongs to the Sobolev type space that is fractional integral of some function of LP. And function G connected to the endpoint, right endpoint, belongs to the corresponding space but with index 1 minus alpha to the right endpoint. And integral, fractional integral to the right point of order 1 minus alpha, but of some function from LQ. P and Q are sufficiently big such that the sum of the inverse does not exceed 1. It can be 1 as we are familiar with this case, let it be. Then we have that fractional derivative of this connected function belongs to LP. Fractional derivative of this connected function, but of the order 1 minus alpha, belongs to LQ. And we understand that we can integrate the product of this derivative to this derivative. And now we give the following definition, immediate definition of the generalized fractional Lebesgue Tilties integral f with respect to g. It is defined in the following way. In general, of course, such integrals were defined from the 30s of 20th century in different way. Young integral is similar to, in some sense, to this one. In some cases, they coincide. But Young integral is not so well constructed. The advantage of this definition of the integral is that it is well constructed. We see all its components. One component is a fractional derivative of integrand f. Another component is a fractional derivative of integrator. And some additional term, which does not matter, we shall see that it can be omitted. And what is the preference? This is one preference of this definition, that we have all the functions, we see all the functions, we have them in hands. And another preference is that this definition does not depend on the possible choice of alpha. What is possible choice? Possible choice is that this derivative exists and this derivative exists. And if both of them exist for two values of, for example, alpha and beta, then we have the same integral. Okay. What about this additional term? If we have alpha p is less than 1, so alpha is sufficiently small, then we can state that this connected function belongs to Sobolev space if and only if simply non-connected function, let us avoid this connection, belongs to the same space. And in this case, we can a little bit transform our integral and simply get the integral which is a Lebesgue integral of the product of fractional derivative without additional term. And what is the advantage of this representation if to compare? Here we have connected function and additional term. Here we have simply function f without any connection and no additional term. Of course, we understand that this representation is preferable, and we shall use it in what follows. Now, maybe two more results. What about, we can define everything. Let it be integral, V equals this one. This is our definition. But now we want to look if this definition appropriate, if it is suitable. And we start with this. Let we have this connected function g to be in our class and also to be continuous. Then if we consider simply integral of indicator with respect to g, that this integral of indicator equals to the following one, and of course it is simply the increment of function g as expected. Okay. Further, let the function g is Hilder continuous, not simply continuous, but Hilder continuous with some exponent lambda. And function, also function g belongs to some Sobolev space with these indexes. Then we have the previous formula again. For any step one, from this function, for any step function, we have a very natural formula for the integral because of linearity of our definition. Of course, every integral should be linear with respect to function f. It is linear. Okay, so we have a nice property. So we suppose that functions are continuous at least at endpoints. If we have now how to connect our integral with the integral with the Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral with respect to function of bounded variation, they should coincide. Yes, they coincide. If the function f is sufficiently smooth for our purposes as before, function g is also as before, but is of bounded variation with some indices, then our integral is simply Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral that we are acquainted from the university course. So in this case, we have the same.
Few questions, so when you're ready,
it will be better to stop here and to emphasize the further properties the next time tomorrow. I agree.
Okay, so first of all, Lucio, who asked about subfractional and bifractional Brownian motions, is asking if any references are available.
I remember. I should write not to forget. So references for bifractional, okay.
And subfractional as well.
Ah, subfractional, yes. It is our book, for me more convenient. But bifractional tutor, okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Then Christina is saying, thank you very much. Just a remark, courses are dense. Personally, I prefer to end some minutes before and leave new subjects to next course. Well,
really, I appreciate a lot, but it was just, but thank you very much. It was, okay,
yeah,
thank you.
Well, yes, I guess, well, it is dense, but well, Yuliya has some material to cover as well, so, and it's only 10 lectures, right? So I also say that they will be exercises and they will be especially useful for PhD students. So if you want to participate in exercises, because as you say, courses are very dense, then please email me and I will add it to the list and email the exercises in this break. Also, the lecture slides will be available in 1 hour or probably half an hour from now from the website, from the main website. So if you go to the main website, right now it's the timetable and the curriculum there, but all the lecture slides will be available. So now, do you have any more questions? Any more questions? Yes.
My question is, I have a question. Is everything is clear? Is it readable? Is it understandable? This is a question to participants.
Yeah, please unmute yourself and say something.
Is it the tempo of the lecture is appropriate?
I can see, yes, everything is clear and the tempo is great. Thank you very much for a very clear presentation.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, if there are no more questions, then thank you very much. Right now you can stay logged in. I will just put some music and we will get back at 1 o'clock for the lectures of Colocolos of you. I will put the slides now on the website of this LMS 20. In some way in the comments there was a link, but I guess you all at some point used it for registration, right? So you know the website. Yes, it is 1 p.m. the same Zoom. You can leave the link open. There will be just music playing here. But see you at 1 p.m. And please do remember to email me, yeah, if you want to join the exercises. Thank you. And thank you very much, Yuliya. Well, that was really nice.
Sorry, can I ask you something, please?
Yes.
I am Stella Sermataki. I'm a math teacher. I would like to ask if we could have the presentation, if you could give us the presentation to have it, to read it by ourselves on our desktop, please.
You mean if the session is recorded? Yes, the session is, just a moment.